The launch date for Flight 9 is getting more solid, suggesting that it may happen sooner than anticipated. Is it really possible for such a rapid development to happen? And what is the status of preparations? Meanwhile, after an extended construction phase, the OLM B pad has been officially positioned. What will happen to the newly introduced launch system? With a focus on the Moon, Japan's lunar lander has successfully reached orbit and is now preparing for its highly anticipated landing attempt. Let's dive deeper in today's episode of NR Studio. SpaceX continues to advance its preparations for Flight 9, with emerging information providing increasingly accurate estimates for the imminent launch. Currently, all indicators point to a launch in the second half of May. Recently, an additional notice has provided further clarification. Unlike previous warnings, which tended to be largely speculative or provide general timeframes, this one sets a precise date. The United States Coast Guard has issued a precautionary warning regarding the potential risks associated with rocket launch operations near Boca Chica, Texas. Specifically, the notice lists May 19th as the anticipated launch date, with a time frame ranging from 6:30 p.m. to 8:30 p.m. Central Time. This puts the anticipated launch just 1 to 2 weeks out, a much shorter time frame than many had anticipated. This effectively aligns with the broader time frame presented in the most recent local notice to mariners, which outlined a launch window ranging from May 19th to May 28th. The Coast Guard notice effectively outlined an earlier date within that time frame, providing a more precise understanding of the potential launch time. In line with this, I found a notice from the Federal Aviation Administration, specifically a NOTAM, Notice to Air Missions, related to Flight 9. While the dates given differ from the Coast Guard's estimates, the more interesting aspect lies in the revised area map delineating risk zones. Importantly, this time, SpaceX and the FAA have included new precautionary zones around Cuba and the Bahamas. Some analysts have hypothesized that this reflects a lack of confidence in the mission, as the designated areas correspond to areas where debris from a malfunctioning vehicle could potentially fall. However, from a safety perspective, this may simply be a precaution. By notifying adjacent areas, SpaceX is increasing safety measures to reduce the risk of an unforeseen incident. In an optimal scenario, Starship is expected to pass through these zones without any problems. However, it is wise to strategize with an eye to the future, considering all potential scenarios. If the launch goes ahead as scheduled on the 19th, it will be a significant milestone. That would surpass previous estimates and represent a significant step forward in the Starship development cycle. However, the key question remains, is SpaceX really ready for the May 19th launch? Given the current progress, the signs are positive. Much of the attention has been on S-35, the spacecraft destined for the upcoming Flight 9. Earlier this month, S-35 underwent two static fire evaluations at Massey, SpaceX's dedicated engine testing facility. However, complications with the vacuum engine were identified during one of the tests. As a result, the operational engine was replaced. As of now, the newly announced road closures have been in place, which set up transportation from the factory to Massey for midnight to AM Central Time on the 9th. They were clearly designed with S-35 in mind. Once S-35 returns to Massey, it will undergo another series of static fire tests similar to the previous protocol implemented. These assessments include a single engine burn and a comprehensive six-engine burn. Specifically, the six-engine test can last a full minute to assess the engine's performance under high-pressure conditions. Importantly, during the burn, the engine appears to modulate its thrust levels, similar to the adjustments required for complex maneuvers during flight. The fire trench system at the Massey site played a critical role in dissipating the extreme heat and pressure generated during the incident. This assessment is critical, not only for its own sake, but because of the fact that its results directly affect the success of the flight. If all goes well and the newly installed engines operate as anticipated, it would indicate that the problem has been fixed. Provided the test is conducted without complications, S-35 is expected to be moved to the production facility soon, likely around the 10th or 11th. Installation of the flight termination system and payload systems is anticipated to take several days, likely to be completed around the 15th or 16th. The vehicle will then be transported to the launch pad for final integration and dress rehearsal, a procedure that typically lasts 2 to 3 days. Meanwhile, B-14, the launch companion for S-35, is significantly further along in its preparation. It underwent its final installation some time ago and is effectively ready to be moved to the launch pad, subject to the team's direction, likely synchronized with S-35 schedule. Given this schedule, a May 19th launch is entirely reasonable, subject to the successful completion of all final system tests without delay. Of course, we have to wait for SpaceX official confirmation before finalizing the date. What are your thoughts on the matter? Do you believe the launch will actually happen on the 19th? If you agree, please say, "Let's do it," in the comments section below. If you choose not to share your prediction, please explain your reasoning. I still have the impression that it could finally happen on the 20th. And don't forget to subscribe to our channel to stay informed of all the developments related to SpaceX and Starship. Your support is invaluable to us, and in that regard, I want to extend my deepest gratitude to everyone who has contributed to the growth of our channel. Let's continue the discussion. Upcoming updates as Flight 9 approaches. As we continue to count down to the long-awaited launch of Flight 9, a major milestone has recently occurred in the near future. The Malfur Orbital Launch Pad B has officially completed its significant transition. As scheduled for the road closure, the OLM designated for the B pad was transported from the Sanchez site to its designated location on Launch Pad B on the evening of May 6th. This is a significant step forward in SpaceX's ongoing efforts to upgrade its launch infrastructure at Starbase. What made this moment even more exciting was the opportunity to examine the new OLM up close. Up until now, our observations have been limited to remote footage or glimpses. However, this current development gives us the opportunity to examine it up close. The structure exhibits a more compact and streamlined shape compared to its predecessor, which was characterized by a boxy and symmetrical design. Both sides feature large openings, likely intended to integrate with the fire trench system. These openings could facilitate ventilation or provide access to underlying support infrastructure. At the top of the OLM, each corner is equipped with a manifold system designed to interface with high-capacity water lines and the fire trench itself. This system plays a critical role in reducing thermal and acoustic emissions during launch. Some scaffolding remains in place, likely to aid in the upcoming integration and outfitting phases. An interesting detail is that the OLM features a tiny red heart-shaped sticker that reads, "Stack Me," reminiscent of the labels that previously adorned the launch tower module of the B pad prior to its assembly. This subtle detail symbolizes the spirit and ethos embedded in the SpaceX team. This initiative marks the culmination of an extensive and painstaking construction effort. Critical steps prior to transportation include the deployment and installation of the support legs on the launch pad, establishing a secure foundation for the OLM. Once on site, the structure will be elevated and secured with the help of two large cranes operating in conjunction with an elaborate array of support cables. The use of dual crane methodology is expected to streamline the process significantly. Following installation, we anticipate the start of a series of evaluations. These could include systematic individual inspections, in addition to comprehensive integration testing. In some cases, SpaceX may use a tank test article to perform these procedures. However, it's anticipated that we will soon see a fully functional booster, potentially B-15, B-16, or even B-17, positioned on the B-pad for a full launch readiness evaluation. If the OLM successfully passes these assessments quickly, the B-pad could be operational sooner than anticipated, perhaps in line with a ship recovery effort as early as the 10th flight. While not officially confirmed, many signs point to the new OLM presenting several advantages over its predecessor. The design features a more compact and efficient structure, with improved integration with support systems such as the flame trench. However, its most significant advantage may be its mobility. The ability to move the OLM for repairs or upgrades between launches could significantly improve turnaround time and facilitate a steady launch cadence. This capability could prove critical, especially given SpaceX's initiative to ramp up to 25 launches per year from Starbase, a rate that requires robust and rapidly maintainable infrastructure. With its innovative B-pad and OLM nearing operational readiness, SpaceX is poised to ramp up its launch schedule with greater dynamism and flexibility. Attention now turns to upcoming developments regarding the B-pad. As efforts continue, we will be closely monitoring SpaceX preparations for this vital piece of infrastructure for its maiden test. Finally, let's turn our attention to the moon, where Japan's Resilience lander recently achieved a major milestone. On May 6th at 1 p.m. Eastern Time, the Resilience lander successfully reached lunar orbit following a successful 9-minute main engine burn. This was its longest maneuver to date. The spacecraft's orbital parameters have not been disclosed. Resilience serves as a companion to the Blue Ghost spacecraft, both of which launched into the cosmos aboard a Falcon 9 rocket in January. While Blue Ghost successfully touched down on March 2nd, Resilience has chosen a more gradual and fuel-efficient trajectory, now preparing for a landing attempt on June 5th. Its target is Mare Frigoris, a basaltic plain located in the northern hemisphere of the Moon. Takeshi Hakamata, founder and CEO of iSpace, the company responsible for Resilience, expressed deep satisfaction with the successful arrival of the Resilience lander in lunar orbit. As intended, we will continue with meticulous operations to ensure a successful landing. NATS is equipped with 5 science and technology payloads, among them a small rover named Tenacious, built by iSpace's Luxembourg division. The rover will collect lunar regolith under a NASA contract while simultaneously transporting an artistic component called Moonhouse, a small installation created by artist Mikhail Ginberg. This marks iSpace's second expedition to the lunar surface. An earlier attempt culminated in a failure in April 2023, caused by a software malfunction. Hakamata noted that the team has integrated insights gained from the mission. "We have deftly executed the maneuvers thus far by leveraging operational insights gained from Mission 1. Japan is aggressively advancing its lunar ambitions, especially given the challenges faced with its sleek lander earlier this year. Looking ahead, the iSpace division in the United States is in the process of building a lander for NASA Commercial Lunar Payload Services, CLPS, mission, scheduled for launch in 2026. A third lander, built in Japan, is scheduled for use in 2027. But before that future materializes, attention is on its endurance and imminent arrival. Let's see if Japan can etch its name into the annals of lunar history. That's it for today's episode. See you in the next one. And thank you for your support.